Well, hello, everyone. Thank you so much for having me. Today, I wanted to talk about some work we've been doing at the company I work for, Platform.sh. We're a platform as a service company you may have heard of. We allow pretty flexible configuration for your applications, including the ability to, with a few YAML files, set up a multi-application container virtual cluster, which is what we'll be looking at today in this particular project. And one of the more recent pieces of research that I did in this conversation of headless CMSs and different things that we can do alongside Drupal, because Drupal is such a big part of our history, is this decoupled headless CMS pattern between Gatsby as a front end and using Drupal to have our content and be this CMS on the back end, separated between these two containers. So maybe I can switch slides. This is a picture of me. Again, I'm Chad Carlson. I work for the developer relations team at platform.sh. So that means I'm primarily responsible for our public documentation. We recently did a huge migration from an older version of our documentation over to Hugo. So we do the actual fixing of the documentation and writing of the documentation. And alongside that, we also write and maintain all of our template projects, which this one I'm about to show you today is one in the works, alongside a few other decoupled projects where we used Gatsby with WordPress, Gatsby with Strapi, and in this one here, Gatsby with Drupal. So for those of you who maybe aren't familiar yet with Gatsby itself, I'm gonna go just through a quick review of the basic concepts of Gatsby and move then on to this ecosystem of source plugins that Gatsby uses in order to pull in content from Drupal, WordPress, what have you, during its build in order to fill out its data layer and build that front-end Gatsby site. Before moving on to sort of how multi-app projects work on platform.sh so that we can actually get what we'd like, pulling content from Drupal into Gatsby working and deployed on platform.sh, and then the final steps of setting that up, the actual configuration important for that multi-app configuration within the application itself. Before I finally want to go into a new feature that we are working on and trying to figure out all the little details of how to make this work as flexible as possible, which is this provided feature on Gatsby, especially for this relationship of Drupal, of live preview. So you have content edits on your Drupal site that results in a development version of Gatsby getting an instant update of that content. If you have a client who really would like to direct themselves toward this headless CMS pattern, it could be a useful one for moving a content edit or any other kind of edit onto an editor up the chain. So first, starting off with Gatsby, it is a static site generator, but they will definitely, if you talk to any of the people who are within Gatsby, they kind of shy away from that label. It's not just that, which really fits into this headless CMS functionality that it provides in pulling this content. It's written in Node.js and some TypeScript and is React-based, and it provides this templating language for creating and generating individual pages, like we're gonna do here with individual articles across a really complicated site. And if we take a look real quick on what the project structure looks like, really the most important ones to what we're gonna talk about today is that you have JavaScript files set within this source pages subdirectory that can be used to define individual routes inside your final application. You have your index.js file, and then you have what we're going to be talking about, an articles list page, articles.js, and then individual templating files. So we have this template article.js that we'll look into that is used for taking some of the content out of an individual Drupal article, making that query and reconstructing it into the Gatsby page as you'd like it to look. Other than that, sort of the two most important higher level files related to getting this Gatsby site up and running are the Gatsby node.js, which is where really all the heavy lifting comes into getting this list of all the articles in Drupal and generating individual pages for each one of them in Gatsby is all done in this Gatsby node.js file. And then finally, this Gatsby config, obviously you might guess, it's your main configuration file that within is going to not just set some site metadata for the final application, but it is going to be the place where you start defining all of these plugins, whether that may be something for designing the site itself, or like we'll get into defining the sources by which you can plug in content, that you can pull in content for building the final site. It is all done in this config.js file. So in this file, you can define a source plugin, which in the case that we would be curious about for Drupal is Gatsby source Drupal. You have an array for plugins that you can install this source plugin for Drupal or WordPress, just like you would any other Node.js module in your package.json file, and then define it in this config.js file and provide it with some attributes that will become a part of the build for Gatsby that says, I want to use this source plugin and this is the base URL from which I want to pull content from. And that's going to be then automatically pointing at this default JSON API endpoint in your Drupal site and get pulled into the Gatsby site. This is part of this larger effort with Gatsby to separate concerns of a single monolithic application to these individual services. In this case, it's specific to the domain of a content management system. It's being set up as a separate service from Drupal, but it could very well be the case that you don't want your development teams focusing on writing some sort of auth layer for your application or anything to do with credit card processing. So you could very similarly define a plugin or a source plugin that fits within this file that can then be channeled into the process of building your Gatsby site. And this creates a trade-off. During my Gatsby build, I'm going to be using this endpoint on Drupal to get all of my content from that Drupal site, which is going to necessarily, it's going to extend my build time for my Gatsby site. But the trade-off and the promise that you're getting there as a result of that is, yeah, you might have a little bit of a long build time, but it's not going to be reflected in any additional load times to the application client side. So that also, I mean, that's a good thing all in itself, I think, but it also creates this additional consequence of the separation where should that Drupal site go down, there's no requests happening client side to fill out this content. So if that Drupal backend happens to go down, your main site that users are about to go look at, it is unchanged because that data has already been pulled in to this data layer from GraphQL during the build step of your Gatsby site. And this is just a quick figure that's included in the Gatsby documentation that kind of goes through or kind of gives an overview of this point where it's not restricted necessarily to content management systems on the back end. We see here that I can use Stripe as a payment module pulled into my Gatsby site, and it will do the exact same thing as it did with content during my Gatsby build and relieve my team from developing any sort of payment processing parts of my application. The same goes with search with Algolia or hosting external data on AWS or something like that, as opposed to this traditional monolithic structure where it all has to sort of be contained within potentially this Drupal ecosystem for this single Drupal app rather than having all my team conflicting maybe in doing these individual components, I can offset them to external components and teams that are entirely dedicated to working on those features. So the goal that we're ultimately going to have then is we're going to have this single Gatsby application and a Drupal application that then needs to communicate with each other. We'd like them to be separate applications. And on Platform.sh, we have like a pretty intuitive, I think, configuration syntax for setting that up. We see in the figure in the top right, this is ultimately what we want to end up with. This is what a service graph looks like on Platform.sh if you haven't tried us out before for setting up a multi-app project like this. We have a router container on the top that directs traffic to our two applications, our Gatsby app, the JavaScript app on the left, and then our Drupal PHP container on the right. They have a relationship defined between them that I will go over in the next slide that allows Gatsby to pull content from our Drupal site during its builds. And then we can define services that either they share, or in this case, my PHP app really only is the only one that needs access to my to Redis and to the database that I've defined for the application. And it results in the final structure of my repository of something on the bottom here. We have shared services YAML file and roots YAML file that directs traffic to, in this case, in the way that I'm doing it here, I have my main domain going to my Gatsby app because that's what I want users to see. And then I have a subdomain backend dot whatever my URL happens to be that directs towards the Drupal app. And that way users aren't interacting with my backend app, and anybody who's in charge of editing content can really restrict their efforts to that backend URL, that backend application. And the way that we start to define those individual application containers is we have subdirectories for each of the apps. We have a Drupal and Gatsby subdirectory, each with their own .platform app YAML file that is going to define, in this case, what runtime we're using, PHP or Node.js, how we want their build to deploys to be executed, and their start commands. So I have a snippet here of the way we define a this is from our Drupal. This is from our Drupal 8 template. So we give the application a name that'll be recognizable by any other application container inside the cluster. The version of PHP that we want is our primary runtime for that application container. Our relationships, the amount of disk we want to give it. In this case, we normally recommend this composer-based build of Drupal. So we just let platform know that's what we want to do. That's the build flavor we want for it. And we can define our build, deploy, and post-deploy hooks for this application container. I've actually snipped out the build hook because it didn't seem relevant to this particular slide. And but when we look at Gatsby, it's a very similar thing. And we're using this post-deploy hook here as the actual step where content is pulled out of the Drupal application. And the reason for that is we have these stages by which applications are fully deployed to a particular project. On every commit and or every push that we place to platform and to an externally integrated repo, it's going to read these configuration files and run our builds and freeze the app containers at a state where they're actually not able to communicate with each other at that point. And that places this restriction on the ultimate goal of setting up a multi-app with Gatsby and Drupal. So we can postpone that step to our post-deploy hook when our Drupal application has fully deployed and the content is available. And when we do that, we can utilize this relationship between the two application containers, which in this case is our Drupal app set up on our Gatsby's platform app YAML file. So that any time within our Gatsby app, if we wanted to pull content or pull any information about that separate Drupal app, we can do it through this defined relationship here that'll just be labeled Drupal. And we'll see when we go into the configuration file that this is actually what we're leveraging to get the content. So as I said before, when we use this Gatsby source Drupal source plugin, we're really relying on this JSON API endpoint on our Drupal application. It's going to allow us to pull in the Gatsby content so far as we define our base URL for where we want that content to come from. We can run this locally without any problem of doing a normal Gatsby build so long as the Drupal app is deployed. But in order to do it on platform, we have to go through this relationship I described before. We grab credentials for this Drupal application and put it into the structure that this source plugin really wants with a host attribute, which in this case, how it's visible to the Gatsby app will be something like Drupal.internal that'll give you enough to actually communicate to that backend application. And then we can use this backend route to define our base URL. Like I said, we can do this locally as well. So I just have a catch included here that we can set an environment variable for that same backend URL if we're testing the Gatsby app locally. So once we've got that configuration set up, the next steps are we need to set up Drupal to have some one-to-one relationship with the way we want our Gatsby app to be displayed. So instead of using the way that Drupal has this final URL of node and this long hash string, we're gonna use path auto to set up this article subdirectory essentially, using a slug of the final article title. We can include this module inside of our composer install and then set it up on our first deployment. Consequence of this first deployment, but because we do it this way, it's interesting, Gatsby will fail the first time, which is what you would expect. We have to complete the first Drupal install. But then once we give it this much information, then the relationship will be set up perfectly fine. We set up this path auto pattern to create a slug from the title and have that be the URL alias for every article in our Drupal site and create a few articles. And once we do a single redeploy, our production master environment will be set up to pull content from Drupal automatically. We'll have this relationship totally set up. I think that the next one. Oh, okay. So I guess it would be important to go into the Gatsby code of sort of why this works. So Gatsby's source plugin system really leverages GraphQL to start taking content from this JSON API that's set up for Drupal. So the two most important files within here of actually setting up that full Gatsby site is our list of articles, articles.js, and an individual article, article.js, in our templates subdirectory. So this is a snippet from the articles page in the page subdirectory that is actually going to place a query using GraphQL on our backend Drupal site that is going to find all of the individual nodes, the alias that's been set for the node using path auto so that we can actually define an individual article page using that Gatsby node.js file to the same slug as we've defined through path auto. We're gonna find this image and alt text and everything else that you would expect, title, body, summary. And then we can feed all that information that we've got from that query into the individual template for an individual page and for our list page here. and leverage this Node.js file to build out the rest of the site. So this is just a quick clip of that fully deployed site. Ignore the fact that it says Drupal 9. This is actually a Drupal 8 application container. I'm working on a Drupal 9 version of it now. But here we have two articles that are actually on our Drupal backend that have been pulled into our Gatsby site that we can pull in the individual image, the title summary on our list page, and then the full body text, which I think got cut off a little bit here. That's the summary. Yeah, it got cut off at the bottom, but it pulls in the text at the bottom of that page. So that's a win for this pattern. You know, we've deployed a headless CMS where we can really delegate responsibilities to content creators to actually writing new content on our Drupal backend, but leave the development team to focus all their energy on the Gatsby site. And so long as this relationship isn't redefined at some point, it will continue to build out this front-end application on Drupal. And like I said before, there can be a situation perhaps where the front-end Gatsby site is getting updated very frequently. This is probably not a common case, but and the back-end content isn't getting updated as quickly. Our Let's Encrypt certificates have like a 3 or 4 month turnaround. If you, for whatever reason, weren't writing content for 3 or 4 months, there might be an issue with actually pulling the content from the URL without that certificate defined if it were to expire during that time. But that wouldn't be an issue at this point for your production app because you've already pulled the content and it's essentially cached inside the data layer of your Gatsby app. So it is independent post-build of your backend Drupal application. So that's great. It's really great, actually. I mean, we have this sort of pattern set up on other templates for WordPress to do a very similar thing. And for Strapi, which is sort of an API builder with a user interface for setting that up, of doing a very, very similar thing. But one thing that sets apart with Drupal is this live preview feature. So if I am creating this headless pattern for a client and I have set up a Gatsby front-end site and a Drupal back-end site that my content creators are totally focused on what articles are in Drupal and we're, you know, doing our own things and keeping the Gatsby site up to date, pulling content from it. I may want to create a workflow where individual content creators can set up a development environment where they can have a preview, essentially, of the new piece of content that they're creating. And Platform.sh is really set up for that. I mean, we take either your integration to GitHub or what have you, or to using your project as your primary remote, and give you the ability for each branch or each pull request in the integration case to deploy a new live environment. So that's great because we could have a branch that's dedicated to a new piece of content. But what this source integration with Drupal allows you to do is actually place a post to the Gatsby site to refresh the content so that you don't require like a full push, a commit and push to Platform or to your repository to test out a single character change or an image change on that front end Gatsby site. And so that's something that we can replicate remotely on these development environments. It's not necessarily a feature that we want on our production site, but it is something that we can give the flexibility to the people who are creating content or editing that content to do on these development environments. And that's done through this live preview module for Drupal. So we, like I said before, during what we'll consider our production Gatsby build, during our production Gatsby build, we're going to run the full build of the site that's going to place one request to Drupal. It's going to use GraphQL to get all of our content, stick it inside the data layer of Gatsby, and build the whole site. When you run Gatsby develop, it's in a development state of Gatsby. And if you include within it a single environment variable, this refresh endpoint, it'll create at the end of your local or deployed Gatsby site, this underscore underscore refresh that you can place post requests to and re-request that Drupal backend content. It'll place another call to JSON API and refresh all the content that's inside your Gatsby site at the moment. So what we've been playing around with at Platform is taking this multi-app configuration that we have, leave it as a typical full build on our production environments, but then on all of our development environments, whether that's a pull request or any other branch that we're working on or designated to an individual content contributor, instead run Gatsby develop with this environment variable so that people not only have a dedicated branch where they can work or where they can preview content, but that once it's deployed, they can continuously edit that Drupal article. And as soon as that article is saved on the development environment, it will ping that refresh endpoint and update the front end Gatsby site. So that at any time somebody says, oh, you got typos here, how about now? And it's automatically refreshed on the front end site. And we do that in these two little scripts here in our Gatsby's app YAML file. So like I said before, you know, normally we would have in our build hook, or sorry, in our, normally if we were running it locally, we would run this full build to pull content from Drupal. And we postponed it to the post deploy hook because that Drupal app just isn't available until that point. But what we can do is we can read from another environment variable, this platform branch environment variable, and detect if it's on master, if it's on our production site, run the full build. We don't want live preview edits to really even be possible on our production site. And then we have a similarly matched one here for our start command that if it was master, it really, you have a full built site in this public subdirectory. So you're just directing traffic through to this final built index.html file that's a result of that build that has all that content one-time request. But if you're not, if you're on a development environment for a pull request, you can run this develop command. You haven't run a full build during the post-deploy hook, and you have this local server sitting there that has the underscore refresh endpoint enabled that you continually ping on that development environment from your Drupal app. Where is this? So we can install the individual modules on our Drupal app that aren't even touched on our production site that not only enables these API modifications to this default, but that gives us that ability to send live preview requests to this refresh endpoint on our front end Gatsby site. And then when we go in, we can actually configure on an individual development environment to set the preview URL of our, oh, this is a typo actually. This shouldn't have the backend subdomain on either of those ones, but you can set that preview URL for the front end app, which on platform is just going to be this PR5 with a hash of the individual environment. And it's going to then have an incremental build server callback that is to this refresh function for all of the content selected at the bottom. So that, like I said, you don't really need to do anything other than log into the Drupal backend, change a piece of content. As soon as you save it, it's updated on the front end application. So this is a quick preview of this working in action on platform. Maybe, okay. So we have here my first article that I showed in the last example. I have a summary written, some text, and then in another window, I have the front end application that has pulled this in during the start command, actually, instead of our post deploy hook, because we're on a development environment. So I can make an individual edit to the body text. And then save that post. And it should be, I think I did a refresh here, but it should be in there. Yeah, there we go. So we have an updated text on our front end Gatsby application. So it gives us this flexibility to, you know, this is sort of the thing that we're working on now, is figuring out maybe what the workflow should really be realistically for an agency creating this for a client. You know, is an editor going to branch for one of their individual content creators and perform the merges themselves in order to create this development environment. But if they do that much, then they will have this live preview server that doesn't need to go through some of the Gatsby itself is setting up this live preview external service that you can set up your Gatsby site to do this exact thing. In this case, they're existing in the same project on platform. But like I said, if you can set up that workflow of the expectation that an editor will create the branch and merge it themselves once they have this chance to look at this live preview server, it really opens a whole lot. And we have the updated text, and I can update some other things too. I can update this image in the same way, and we'll get the exact same update here in just a second. There we go. So it did take a second for the image to get there, but not all that much time for you to make incremental changes to your content and have these previews on your Gatsby site. So like I said, we're thinking a lot about these days on what's the expectation of workflows that maybe an editor and content creators can really stick to when with a pattern like this. We do provide a CLI tool that can be installed in the individual app container. So the possibility has been pushed around of removing sort of an editor's responsibility to use it directly or to even go through GitHub or anything like that and have a button exposed that creates a branch for somebody that they want to create a piece of content for and merge when they've done some approval. The other thing that we're working on now is, I'll admit, Drupal is not my primary community of experience. I came originally from MATLAB originally. I don't know if anybody's familiar with that, but then Python after that for a long time. So Drupal is a framework that I've been working with only the last year and a half or so. So I've come myself to a sort of the first real hurdle in a personal project that, you know, it's the first one I've come across really, which is on a production environment, there's not really any need to set any fields within this live preview server URL. That refresh endpoint isn't exposed. So we don't want live preview on our production site. And so we don't really have to worry about defining it either. On these development sites, it's a nice feature. You know, a single person can have a dedicated development environment to make their changes, and we can very quickly go through this cycle of incremental updates and continue to have this live preview server. But you have to define the preview URL and the callback hook URLs manually within this module. So maybe this is a call for some help, maybe. I'm not sure. What we're looking to do is to take some of these environment variables that we already have present in our system that can define our front-end application through this relationship I spoke of in our app.yaml file, and automatically override the settings of this module in individual development environments. Because if we can get that, then we really, I think, would have the full showcase of what I think that this is possible doing it on platform that sets it apart maybe of using an external service like Gatsby's separate live preview servers, their live preview service that on every development environment that's created, it'll automatically pull from this relationship the current backend application for that environment and fill out and override the settings inside of this module automatically so that every environment gets that same treatment with none of this manual configuration that I certainly wouldn't expect an editor to fill out for themselves every time that they wanted a new article to be posted. So that's sort of where we are with that. It's an interesting problem, and we've been working on it for a little while now. And that's sort of what I wanted to get to today. Platform is a great tool for doing some of these headless patterns. Like I said, we have an existing template for relating Gatsby to a backend WordPress and Strapi applications. And this one is, I think it's once we get over this last little hurdle, going to be its own template soon to come that people can try out on platform. I am really, again, very thankful for you guys allowing me to join you and happy to take any questions about this or platform or anything you might have.
Thank you, Chad.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for this excellent presentation. Problem here is that I don't see any questions in Q&A section. Does it mean that we have a problem with ability to ask questions for people, or somebody couldn't find where to ask? We can see
one in Q&A now.
Yeah.
I saw this name a couple times, so Alexander. So the first one is, yeah, did you have a chance to mix static content with dynamic content unique per authorized user? If so, how did you handle that? No, I mean, most of the stuff that I played with was really just seeing if this was something that we could get working in the first place, purely with static article content from Drupal. I don't think that there would be any issue with it, but I don't have any experience with it personally. According to my understanding, preview functionality is possible only on dev environments, and it works with published content only. What about getting that working with workflow and content moderation? I believe that at the very least, you can restrict publishing a little bit so that it doesn't actually get pinged to the development server. But the way that our workflow sort of works in the first place is that we're not necessarily restricting you to a typical production staging individual development environment sort of workflow. So you really could, with the adjustment that I spoke of at the end there, set up, essentially organize your branches around whatever moderation workflow that you want it to do. So you very well could have a dedicated staging server where content contributors have children off of that branch where they can have this, you know, incremental live preview, but a merge doesn't necessarily go into production until it has some final moderation step, included in it. Yeah, I think that's how I see it working so far with our platform.
I hope that was a great answer to Alexander's question.
Yes, Alexander agrees.
Do we have other questions?
Looks like there are no other questions right now. So thank you, chat. It was very detailed and informative.